We welcome you to worship on this World Communion Sunday that was sort of reflected in what you just saw in the prelude. And also there are going to be some kids who I met with this past Thursday with their families who are going to be receiving communion for the first time today. So that's another exciting thing happening today. Let me make a few announcements. You'll find these on your announcement sheets. You'll notice that next Sunday, Sean Walker, our missionary to Central Asia, will be reporting on his work during worship. For those who would like to learn more about his work or to meet Sean, we're going to have a lunch together at 12:15 at the Pike, and you are invited to come. Also, you'll have opportunity, you see, if you'd like to serve as an usher in one of the other services. There's an announcement about that. Good news, the pictorial directory sign-ups have gone so well that we need to open up another day for folks to get their pictures done. So if you're not signed up yet, there's still time, and you'll see the details Tuesday, October 24th from 2 to 9. You can either talk to Cheryl Betts or you can sign up on the website. You'll notice the grief support series begins on October the 29th. There's a good bit of detail about that. Reminder, we've got coffee after service, and we're extending it to after the 11 o'clock service as well. So I hope you'll take time to meet some folks out there after the service. Also, we are having a sort of a health gathering for folks who want to get their flu shots this year, and that's on Thursday, October 12th from 12 to 3, and there are details about that in the announcement sheet. Finally, as I mentioned before, this is World Communion Sunday, and the artwork there was done by Max Bernier, one of our sixth graders. And on this World Communion Sunday, Christians are meeting in thatched huts in Guatemala and in the great cathedrals of Europe, in storefront churches in downtown Detroit, and on ships at sea, in homes scattered throughout China, and on military bases of almost every nation, river churches on stilts in the Philippines, and hidden places in Saudi Arabia and North Korea, under trees in the Serengeti, and right here at GPC. All are one church, together remembering Jesus at the Lord's Supper. You'll notice hints and references to this special World Communion Sunday and songs and prayers in today's service. And we hope you'll enjoy this special Sunday. Also, take note that during the first praise song, our fourth and fifth graders are going to be bringing breads from around the world forward to put on the table here. I think it's time to sing together, so please stand and someone turn the lights on. Thank you.
Time for our kids to leave for Sunday school, and everyone else, let's greet each other. We continue to pray, of course, every week for little McKenna Boss. And this week we are asked to pray for Jerry Althoff, who will have back surgery this coming Thursday at Pinnacle Health in Harrisburg. Will you please pray with me? Lord, we come into your presence this morning as thankful people. We have received so much from your hand. In the beginning, you made the heavens and the earth, creating a place for us to live. You formed us from the dust and breathed into us the breath of life. Throughout the days of our lives, you sustain us with food and clothing and shelter, with family and friends. Compared to the rest of the world, we spend our days in luxury and peace. We enjoy freedom and security in this country, a nation that you have blessed with riches and strength. Despite these blessings, Father, we confess that we often keep our distance from you. We're distracted by so many things, by jobs and money and family pressures and preoccupation with leisure and entertainment. Having received abundant blessings from your hand, we are quick to turn to other things and walk paths that lead us away from you. Give us, Lord, the presence of mind to stop, to turn back and draw near to you so that we can simply say thank you. Help us also to recognize the gifts of others and to see the many ways in which we rely on our neighbors and those you've surrounded us with in this life. Give us the wisdom to look them in the eye as well, to acknowledge them, to listen to them, to value their opinions, to give our gratitude and appreciation to and for them. Thank you, Lord, for the Presbytery of Carlisle and for all that it does to help our church and the other churches in our presbytery. Bless those who make difficult decisions and coordinate efforts to govern. Bless those who provide educational supplies and who teach classes. Lord, we pray for those in Syria who lost loved ones this week from ISIS bombing and for those who still live with such terrible violence and unrest in that area. We continue to pray for those in Houston and the Gulf Coast region, in Florida, the Bahamas, and other places who've had such disastrous storms and flooding recently. We pray specifically this morning for Puerto Rico. We pray that power will be restored. We pray that fuel can be distributed. We pray that cargo can be unloaded and efforts can be coordinated despite most communications being out in so many places. We pray that everyone who needs shelter will continue to have a safe place to stay, and that people will be able to live so closely together without clashes. We pray for waters to recede. We pray that the outbreak of cholera that sometimes follows flooding will be stemmed, and that those who need medical care will be able to obtain it quickly. Thank you, Lord, for all those who are attempting rescue, rebuilding, and medical efforts. We ask that you give those people strength and stamina for the job ahead. We pray for little McKenna. We ask that you strengthen her body and fight any invasive illness. We thank you for her upbeat spirit, and we ask that you continue to give her patience for this process and joy during her days. We pray for Jerry and ask that his surgery go well and that the outcome be positive. We pray for all those who grieve. We ask, Father, that you support those who sorrow, comfort those who hurt, and heal those who suffer. Give us all strength to follow you with obedience and passion, but give us also patience to pause, reflect, and give thanks in all circumstances. We pray all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught all disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Will the ushers please come forward for this morning's offering?
In a Calvin and Hobbes comic strip, 6-year-old Calvin says, "I feel bad that I called Susie names and hurt her feelings. I'm sorry I did that." His stuffed tiger friend Hobbes replies, "Maybe you should apologize to her." To which Calvin responds, "I keep hoping there's a less obvious solution." The last couple weeks, we have focused on a verse from 2 Corinthians 5:17. Say it with me. "So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new." But as Calvin reminds us, becoming new people isn't easy, even when we understand what we need to do. Anyone who's tried to change their diet, implement an exercise program, stop smoking, or cut down on their screen time knows how difficult changing habits can be. Today, we're going to focus on how we become new. Let's look at the two verses that follow verse 17. "All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation." That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. Notice two things. First, making all things new is God's work. As Paul writes, all this is from God. We can cooperate with it or resist, but making all things new is God's work. And one of the ways we're made new, one of the ways we are made better people, is that we have a different relationship with God. Because of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we have been reconciled to God. God no longer holds our sins against us. That's wonderful news, and it transforms our relationship with God. Because from the beginning, sin has put us at odds with God. Remember what Adam and Eve did after their first sin? They hid from God. But we don't have to hide anymore. Many of us feel guilt or shame or fear and spend a lot of time hiding from God or trying to appease him with all our good deeds. But we don't have to do that anymore. You have been reconciled with God. Your sins are forgiven. So let them go, like God did. God is now your friend. This is a new relationship. You are reconciled with him. And it's through our new relationship with God that the changes in our human relationships that we talked about last week are possible. It's through a growing relationship with God that we become aware of the ways we need to change and are empowered by the Holy Spirit to make those changes. So let's talk a little bit about how we can help that relationship with God to be nurtured and to grow. We begin with the influence of other people. For some people, it's through their families. In his second letter to a young pastor named Timothy, Paul writes this: I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, lives in you. Timothy's grandmother and mother passed the faith along to Timothy. That's how many of us came to faith, through the words and example of family members, parents, grandparents, aunts and uncles, cousins, older siblings. I'm going to preach about how families can do a better job of this in just a couple weeks. God also uses other people to help us in our relationship with God. Peter wrote these words: Now, as an elder myself, a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as one who shares in the glory to be revealed, I exhort the elders among you, tend to the flock of God that is in your charge, exercising the oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you do it, not for sordid gain, but eagerly. Church leaders, pastors, elders, Sunday school teachers, VBS workers, small group leaders, choir, band, and children's music directors, church leaders can help influence our relationship with God. I remember how much I admired my youth director when I was in high school. I wanted to be like him. And since he was a serious follower of Jesus, I found myself wanting to be one too. God uses church leaders to help us grow in our relationship with God. Are there church leaders who have helped you or are helping you now to grow closer to God? And if you are a church leader, are you passing the faith along to others? Is that a priority for you? But it's not just leaders. God uses everyone who follows him to assist others in their faith journey. From Colossians, which we worked in last week, Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. Teach and admonish one another, he says. Christian friends can help each other learn to know God and encourage each other in the faith. This may take place in classes or small groups, choirs, fellowship groups, or over coffee at the Ragged Edge. Bonnie and I enjoy watching TV shows like those found on PBS and the Discovery Channel, which feature wildlife from remote and exotic places. One of the things that we have learned after in our many years of watching animals trying to survive being eaten by other animals is this: don't get separated from the herd. When an animal gets separated from the herd, look out. He or she may not be long for this world. It's a little bit like that in our relationship with God, without the blood and gore. We're not designed to grow in our relationship with God alone. We need the help of others. So God provides them, families, leaders, and fellow believers to help us grow. God also helps us grow through the scripture. Later this month, we'll celebrate the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. One of the insights of the Reformers was that every believer can read and understand the scripture, God's word to us. Now, sometimes we need some assistance, a study Bible, a group, or a class. But God speaks to us through his word. And as we study it more, we become better able to understand more and more of it. Prayer is another important part of growing in our relationship with God. It provides us with an opportunity to listen to God as well as talk to God. You might use a written prayer, like the Lord's Prayer, as a guide. But keep in mind that prayer with God doesn't always require getting down on your knees for extended periods of time, although those times are valuable. Brad Kent wrote this about prayer: "What I've discovered is that I can be with God in different ways. I don't have to come to God's presence with head bowed and hands folded. I now know that prayer can be as simple as breathing, as active as dancing, as noisy as singing, as quiet as extended silence, as repetitious as reciting a verse of scripture over and over, or as creative as shaping a lump of clay." End quote. Prayer is talking to God and listening to God. And as with any human relationship, it is often through conversation that our relationship with God deepens. Teresa of Avila was leading a group of nuns walking to a new convent. They got caught in a sudden downpour. They needed to cross over a swelling stream on a rickety bridge, so she prayed, "Lord, let this bridge hold up so we can pass." The bridge collapsed. So she continued in prayer, "God, if this is how you treat your friends, it's no wonder you've got so many enemies." Now, some of you may think that sounds like a sacrilegious prayer, but it's very similar to some prayers in the Bible, in the Psalms, for example. People like Moses and David in the Old Testament can be very direct and honest with God, just like they would be with a close friend. Prayer helps develop that kind of relationship with God. Finally, we get closer to God through service. On three different occasions, The Apostle Paul wrote about the gifts and abilities God gives each one of us, instructing us to use them for God's service. And Jesus says that as we serve those who are most in need, we are serving him in disguise. I've been going on and leading mission trips for over 40 years. One of the things I've noticed is that when we debrief a trip at the end, inevitably, people talk about how their relationship with God has grown. I think part of the reason for that is the service we do on these trips. Service invites us to get outside of ourselves a little bit, see what God is up to among people in other places. Another part of it is the fact that we spend time in prayer and studying God's word each day. Part of it is the way we see and hear how others, people in our own group, as well as people in the community we're serving, we hear and see how they're seeing and experiencing God in their lives. All of these practices that help us grow in our relationship with God are available on a mission trip. Maybe you should go on one. God is in the business of making us new, of helping us break habits and speaking and acting that are harmful to ourselves and to other people, giving us compassion and love for others. This isn't something that God did only in faraway biblical times. God is doing it now. Given what took place in Charlottesville last month, I thought of this recent story from the Charlottesville Observer newspaper because I think it makes this point well. The story begins, Nickeltown Presbyterian Church, a predominantly black church in South Carolina, received an anonymous gift of $2,000 just when it was seeking grant money to help transport children to church and feed them breakfast. The gift included a typed letter in which the donor said he was a former racist who had been changed by Jesus and the Holy Spirit working through the church. End quote. This is powerful stuff. If anyone is in Christ, there's a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. That includes racists in South Carolina and racists here in Pennsylvania. It includes those driven by greed and those who are callous to the needs of others. It includes those who are sexually lost and those who withhold their love from those who need it. It includes those who gossip and slander others and those who refuse to forgive a wrong done to them. It includes those who confuse what is truly important with what really doesn't matter. It includes you, and it includes me. Thank God for that. I'd like to close with a poem written by the pastor of the Presbyterian Church in Newville in our presbytery. I'll read the lines marked L for leader. You'll read the lines marked C for congregation. And we'll both read the lines marked A for all. It's entitled New Creation. The old me is reckless in my speech. Out with the old. In with the new. The old me deserves what I want. Out with the old, in with the new. The old me is easily embittered. Out with the old, in with the new. The old me asks, what about me?
New me.
out with the old, in with the new. The old me is a creation of the world. Out with the old, in with the new. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you love us enough, that you sent your Son to die for us so that our sins could be forgiven and we could be reconciled to you. And we thank you that you continue to work in our lives through the power of your Spirit to change us, to make us new. Help us to cooperate with that work in our lives. And also be of assistance to those around us who need to grow in their faith. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're about to celebrate the Lord's Supper together. And we want you to know that this is a sacrament that is available to all of us who put their trust in Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. So if you already know, you are welcome to come. And the way we celebrate the sacrament in this service is people will come forward, take a piece of bread, dip it in the cup, and receive it that way. We're also happy this morning to welcome some kids who went through their class this week to prepare them for communion, and they'll be receiving the Lord's Supper for the first time. On the night in which he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread. After he gave thanks, he broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And he said, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed with my blood. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, show forth the Lord's death until he comes again." Brothers and sisters, this is the body of Christ broken for you and the blood of Christ shed. Elders, please come.
Please come.
In remembrance of me, eat this bread.
us pray. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity this day to gather with Christians around the world to remember your deep and abiding love for us, which is commemorated in this sacrament. We thank you that this sacrament also reminds us that you go with us from this place, empowering us to do your work in the world. For all these things, we give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand for our closing song. Following the service, you are invited into Fellowship Hall, where you can continue participating in this World Communion Sunday. Lou has set up a globe and a world map and some sticky notes. And if you have prayer concerns for people or events in different parts of the world, you can write them on those notes and affix them to the map or the globe as you would like. Now go from this place to love the Lord and love the people. To serve the Lord and serve the people. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain in your hearts forever. Amen. Amen.
in peace. Have a wonderful week. Hello.